A warm welcome to Stockholm, Alan Rusbridger. Sometimes as editor, you end up in strange places and at strange conferences. A personal memory that I have that is connected to the things we will discuss here today. This was last fall, and I was at the media conference, quite a boring media conference, in Las Vegas, of all places. And it was 5 a.m. in the morning, and I was at the Bellagio Hotel, looking out of my window at the mighty Eiffel Tower, and thinking, is this to be an editor? What it is to be an editor? But unexpectedly, I received an email from The Guardian, and suddenly my professional life became meaningful again, because that email was about a very important thing, I think. You were under attack, not only from the British government, but also from parts of the British press. And the email basically was a pledge to editors around the world to support you. And it was the easiest thing for me to do. I just replied, yes, I'm on it. Mm. Because I think you've done an extremely important work, and you are doing an extremely important job at this very moment. So a warm congratulations to the award. I think it's so much well deserved.
Thank you.
And I feel pleased and honored to have you here on stage. Let's go back to that moment, the fall of 2013, when you reached out to editors throughout the world. What was the background? What motivated you, your outreach?
Well, there are two pieces of context. One is that The Guardian is not the most popular paper in Britain, because we did the story about phone hacking. And it's a kind of unwritten rule that you don't write about other journalists if you're a journalist. I don't know if it's the same here. And the News of the World closed. A lot of journalists were prosecuted. And so when The Guardian got into trouble, the British press was not going to rush to The Guardian's help. That was one bit of context. The second bit of context is more general, which is, I think, about the... Everyone is frightened of discussing the subject. But by that, I don't mean journalists, I don't mean academics or NGOs. I think anybody in politics finds this a very difficult subject to discuss for understandable reasons. And there are tensions, of course, between a free press and national security. Those are not the only tensions in this story, but that is one of them. I think there is a confusion about what the role of a newspaper is when it comes to this subject. And surprisingly to me, even some journalists felt that if the state determined what the national interest was, then it was not for a journalist to question the state. And that, to me, is the most profound mistake you could make as a journalist, to confuse the belief that the state is synonymous with the national interest. I think if you start believing that, then you should get out of journalism. But nevertheless, there were three or four British newspapers who came to the conclusion that if the state were saying this was not in the national interest, then it was not for a journalist to reach a different conclusion. And you're right to say that the Guardian came under quite severe attack from the government, from the intelligence agencies, from other newspapers, questioning whether we were traitors or not. The police were put onto us. We were called to Parliament, and it was quite an ugly moment. But I had no doubt that if you went out to editors across the world, that they would see it differently. And you know, I emailed about 45 editors, and I think 44 replied within a few hours with very powerful statements saying that what The Guardian is doing is right. And we printed them all in the paper, and I think it was a very powerful thing to have done, and thank you for doing it. because I think it made the British government think twice before sending the police in.
I think this was the editor of the Daily Mail. It's not a small newspaper. It's one of the world's largest. And he said that you enabled Britain's enemies. How does it feel to hear that from a colleague or a competitor in the press?
Well, I mean, we didn't take any of this lightly. I mean, we thought about that a great deal. And I think if people want to say that you would hope they had evidence for it, but we were sort of prepared for that argument, but it's a slightly different argument from the one that says that journalists must take their cue from the intelligence services. I mean, as journalists, it must be the same in Sweden. There are so many occasions on which you are told it's not in the national interest to publish X, Y, and Z. And in fact, we did a big double-page spread of all the occasions in which journalists had been told it was not in the national interest to publish X, Y, and Z. And it could be the story of thalidomide. It could be the story of... The Sunday Times did a big investigation into Kim Philby, the British spy. So that we had about 10 examples of things where at the time we were told, I mean, WikiLeaks was another example. We were told we were causing terrible harm with WikiLeaks, that we would have blood on our hands, exactly the same language. But I met a very senior figure in Whitehall the other day, and when I mentioned WikiLeaks, he said, oh, WikiLeaks was nothing, but this one's really serious. And I said, well, that's not what you were saying at the time. You were saying this was terribly serious and that we would have blood on our hands. So... So for me to say they always say that sounds glib, but they always do say it.
But is there anything particular about Britain here? Because Spiegel published things about on the NSA, the Washington Post did, the New York Times did, but they were not attacked the way you were attacked.
No, well, I think there was terrible and remains because one or two papers are still very hostile to The Guardian on this subject in Britain, in a way that simply wasn't true in Germany, wasn't true in the United States. So I think there was, but I mean that may have more to do with the first bit of my answer, which was to do with the phone hacking. They just feel cross with us, I don't know.
Let's talk more about the phone hacking, because you mentioned WikiLeaks, because it's not only the NSA revelations that put The Guardian at the center of journalism. Over the last years, really been a number of stories that have shaken the world. Is there a link between these stories? And what is that link?
The Guardian.
The Guardian. What about the content?
Well, I say that slightly glibly, but I think, I mean, it's no secret that during the last 10 years, The press everywhere has been hit by a series of body blows financially to do with technology and to do with advertising going and so on and so forth, and a lot of newspapers responded by just cutting back on the journalism that is most essential to being a newspaper. So if you respond by cutting back your foreign bureau, so you become more insular. If you respond by cutting back on your investigative journalism, so you become blander, then I think you lose sight of why people read you in the first place. And we didn't do that. And so therefore, people brought us stories. We still had the resource and the capability not only to write the stories and investigate them, but to defend them. And I think that's it. I mean, that's why we've had this series of extraordinary stories. But there's no great mystery as to how you get stories. You employ brilliant journalists and you send them out there and they come.
Just to recall, what was the phone hacking scandal really about in your mind?
Well, the phone hacking scandal was about. I mean, the story was that a number of journalists on a number of British tabloid newspapers, but it primarily started on Rupert Murdoch's News of the World, discovered that you could, I mean, in a way it's not dissimilar from the spy story, that modern technology enabled you to intrude into people's lives in a quite spectacular way, a quite illegal way. So people discovered that you could hack into phone messages and get great stories. And the News of the World, for a number of years, just won every award that was going. And we all thought they were great journalists, you know. And it turned out they were just hacking into people's phone messages and getting the stories that way.
And that can never be great journalism.
No, I don't think so. No, I mean, and these were stories about people's private lives. And Nick Davis, our fantastic reporter. I mean, you know that the two journalists were eventually caught, went to prison, the journalist and the private investigator. And then at some point, Nick discovered that News of the World had paid silence money. Rupert Murdoch had paid silence money of around £1 million to somebody else, which proved that this was not a rotten apple in the paper, that this was systematic. So he spent 5 years on this story, proving that this was something that was systemic within the paper, and that News International, when they knew about it, either tried to cover it up or lied about it. And that the significance was that News International is a huge company in Britain. It owned 40% of the British press. So when we started writing this story, we watched everyone in the state run for cover because they were so frightened of this group. So the police ran for cover, the regulator ran for cover, the MPs turned their backs, and once again, we were on our own looking at this story. And that to me was the significance, that it, in the end, it was about media power and what happens if you allow one individual too much power, and the enormously menacing things that then happens to the state.
You stood up to private power, in this case the private power of Rupert Murdoch. How much did you think about his response before you published?
I gulped a bit. I mean, these were nasty people to take on.
Did you ever hesitate?
No. I think as an editor, if you have a reporter who has a story that's true and you believe in, then you have to support your reporter and publish or find another editor. I mean, that in the end is our job.
Were you worried?
Yeah, I was worried because it's for all the reasons that everybody else ran for cover, because this was a big, powerful, quite nasty news organization, and as it turned out, they played quite nastily against us.
What did they do?
Well, they tried to investigate us, and they tried to threaten us. They used their other papers to attack us. Watching the police dance attendant to this newspaper group was quite shocking. And when we published the first story, the police said, "We're going to launch an investigation into this," and they came back a few hours later and said, "We've investigated it, there's nothing wrong." It was quite extraordinary. So within a day, as we were expecting the rest of the press to start following up our stories, the police came out and said, "No, there's nothing here." And years later, the police apologized. Years later, the police resigned. But on the day, they managed to close down the story. And you looked around and you thought, "My God, this newspaper has real friends in power around the place."
How much did that surprise you, that the official reaction was so much in line with the Murdoch group?
Well, it did surprise me. I mean, I've never felt myself to be a conspiracy theorist, so I've never sort of held Rupert Murdoch up to be a terrible demon. But when you saw the police behave like that, and the press regulator said, we'll investigate this, and then they came out with a report that said, we can find no evidence. In fact, they turned the guns on the Guardian, and they said, in fact, we think it's the Guardian that has exaggerated this. So the press regulator was nobbled, the police were nobbled, the people you thought in Parliament would stand up and say things didn't. And the rest of the press, of course, you thought, the press is not going to write about this story. And so here was a very powerful thing within a state that had virtual impunity. And that's, believe me, you don't want that to happen in a country.
Is the problem still there? Or is it solved?
Well, I think, I mean, Murdoch still owns...
If you define the problem as Rupert Murdoch, but...
Well, no, I mean, it's not about him necessarily, though that was an organization that was literally out of control. I mean, he can't have it both ways. Either he was in control of it, and he should then take criminal responsibility for it, or it was out of control. And his story is that it was out of control. He knew nothing about it. So there was an organization that was out of control at the heart of Britain. Now, I think it's more in control now. I think the illegality by journalists, you'd have to be a very stupid journalist to behave that illegally again. But there are as I think by and large, things are better.
We're talking about Britain now, but if you look at other European countries, what do you see? How much should we worry about these things? Are we naive?
I don't know about the tabloid culture in other countries. I don't know whether this was a particularly British thing. I mean, obviously, the state of the press in all countries is something we should worry about.
You moved from one huge story to another, and that was WikiLeaks. In your mind, who is Julian Assange? Who is he? You've seen him?
I've seen him, yeah. He's he's many things. He can be brilliant, he can be infuriating, he can be extremely clear-sighted, he can be very quixotic. He's not a source, but he's a sort of intermediary to a source. He's an activist, he's a publisher, he's a journalist, he's an impresario. So he has many, many identities.
You did a story on WikiLeaks together with the New York Times. Mm. Why was that important for you?
Well, I think there's something about the modern technologies, which I think as journalists we should take advantage of, which is that if you can spread stories out across jurisdictions, then you can have protections and not available in one country. And I think this is an incredibly important thing about modern life, which maybe we don't do enough of. So if you have a very repressive press in this country here, a very repressive government, it is relatively easy from this place to report on that place and the government can't get at you. So the thinking behind going to the New York Times was that we were fairly sure that the government in Britain would come for us in London, and in London they have laws that enable them to do this. Whereas in America, actually thanks to Daniel Ellsberg, who's here in Stockholm, and the Pentagon Papers, it's very difficult, almost impossible for the American government to try and restrain publication in advance. So we took the decision to partner with the New York Times so that we had this kind of bridge to the First Amendment.
They have a stronger protection of the press, basically.
Because
of the First Amendment.
I think so. I mean, yeah. If you talk to American journalists, they're a bit grumpy about their protections at the moment. But the First Amendment does mean you can't walk into a newspaper office and stop people from publishing in advance.
Because when you say that they would come to us, the government, what would they actually do?
Well, they would injunct you.
And it would be impossible for you to publish the story.
They would. You would face a 2 or 3 year court battle in order to persuade a judge to let you publish. Is this the same in Sweden?
No.
No. Right. Okay. Well, I mean, all these things are terribly disappointing because in Britain, those of you who know your British press history, you know, these were battles that were fought in the 17th century. I mean, John Milton wrote this great pamphlet, whose name I can never pronounce, Areopagitica. There, I said it. These were great battles that were fought in the 17th century precisely on this issue of not having prior censorship. And here we are in the 21st century, and the British state still has the power to say you can't publish that in advance. So that's in WikiLeaks. That's why we went to the New York Times.
How often did you have the creepy feeling that Julian Assange was trying to exploit you?
I didn't feel that.
No. You didn't feel that?
No.
He was not trying to
I should have done.
Provide you with false information or anything else that made you skeptical of him? Because you fell out with him.
Well, we
over time.
But not over the documents. The documents were all genuine. No one said that they weren't. We had the same access to the documents that he did, and we worked on them independently. And so I didn't feel there was anything awkward about that. I mean, it was a very complicated story to do because we had not only the New York Times, we had Der Spiegel, the New York Times was a daily paper on one time zone. We were a daily paper on another time zone. Julian at some point brought in Der Spiegel, which was a weekly paper on a slightly different time zone. And then at different points, Julian would suddenly bring in Le Monde or El País or whoever. So trying to coordinate that number of publishers around material that was sensitive and was being redacted. And Julian had, at that stage, himself disappeared. We didn't know where. Turned out he was in a country house in Norfolk. So communication was quite difficult. So logistically, it was a difficult story to do. But we didn't really fall out over. I didn't feel exploited in any way.
What was the reason then that you broke with him, or that he broke with you?
I think there were two reasons. One that because communications were so difficult. I mean, I think this would have been a difficult story even if we'd all been in the same room, meeting on the same day. If you're trying to do a story that complexity, and the other person is only on the end of an encrypted chat line, and even then, not always there, I think that's not great for communications. So that got a bit scratchy because in the end we had sort of different lines. We were trying to be quite cautious about a redaction. And as it transpired, we now know he didn't really have the mechanism to do redactions on the scale that we were doing them. And the second reason was over the whole Swedish rape allegations. Nick Davis, who again was involved in this story and who brought the story in, was completely clear that we had to. You know, we couldn't afford not to publish that or somehow shield Julian from this because we were his publishing partner and we had to publish what the allegations were. And that created tensions.
Is there anything fishy about, strange about those accusations in your mind that are here in Sweden?
I don't know. I mean, we
Do you think he has reasons to worry about going here, aside from the accusations that Sweden would extradite him to the US?
I mean, you would know better than I do.
Yeah. Edward Snowden. What similarities do you see between Edward Snowden and Julian Assange, and what are the differences?
Well, the similarities would be around their awareness and their expertise in what's possible in terms of surveillance and hacking and monitoring people. They both have great capabilities and knowledge of that, and I think both need. We should listen to both with great respect. Snowden's a different kind of character from Julian. He's more even-tempered.
You haven't met him, Snowden.
I have met him. Yeah.
Oh, you have met him.
I have met him. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
He is a source. Julian wasn't a source. Snowden is not a publisher. Julian was a publisher. Snowden's not a journalist. Julian wants to be thought of as a journalist. So there are differences and similarities.
There was an incident in the Guardian's basement at the beginning of the NSA when you published the NSA story. I'm not sure that everyone here has heard about it. Would you mind retelling that story? What happened at the Guardian?
Well, after a while of publication of these stories, the British state got in touch, as I expected that they would. And they sent an emissary in the form of the cabinet secretary to come and talk to me. And he said, "I think you've done enough now." And I said, "We'd barely begun."
He was sitting in your room.
He came to my office, yes, and
you let him in.
I let him in. It was a very polite conversation.
Could you have declined?
Well, it goes back to our earlier conversation. Yeah. If you know the state has that power to stop you, then I think declining to see him might have provoked them to do something. So I was interested to talk to him. I think you, on material of this sensitivity, you have a duty to engage with the state and to try and have a dialogue with them. In that conversation, I persuaded him, I think, that we should be allowed to publish more. He went away, and then 2 weeks later, he sent somebody back to say, "That's it, your time's up." I said, "Well, I don't think that's for the state to say. We're independent from the state, we're publishing this material, and we haven't finished yet." But it became clear that they absolutely were determined to stop us. And so this sort of dance began in which I once again went to the New York Times because of this ability to burn the bridge and to ProPublica. I told the British government what we were doing. I said, "You do understand that if you destroy a computer here, that's not going to stop us publishing." They claimed to understand that was true, but nevertheless, they said they wanted to destroy the computers.
Physically,
yeah. So we then had a discussion about how that would happen, and this, I mean, was the most bizarre thing in my time as a journalist. The British state came into the newspaper office, into our basement, and we bought a lot of Black and Decker drills and angle grinders, and then they told us how to destroy a circuit board, which is more complicated than you think.
What went through your mind?
It looked very sinister. I mean, we filmed it, so I thought, this is going to, this will just look terrible for the government when we write about it, which we didn't immediately. I thought it was pointless. It was completely pointless because it was not going to stop us. I thought it was a terrible mistake by the British government because, and we talked about all this. I said, "Look, you do realise that Glenn Greenwald, the Guardian journalist who's writing about quite a lot of this, lives on the edge of the Brazilian jungle in Rio. He's not going to stop. So would you rather deal with him or me?" because they had no link to him at all. I mean, so at least, I mean, I think this is if there are people here on the sort of government side of things, who would you rather deal with in this new information ecostructure when anybody can publish? And if you try to close down mainstream responsible papers, you're simply just going to drive publication into other hands.
So why on earth did they force you to destroy your computer if they couldn't stop you anyway?
I don't know. I mean,
what was the motive?
I've had conversations with them since, and they say, well, in retrospect, it was a bit pointless, wasn't it?
Did they want to frighten you?
I think maybe they wanted to make things more difficult. There was an American spy novelist who was a spy, whose name I can't remember, who tweeted at the time. He said this is just throwing sand in the wheels, that the Guardian was having too easy a time, and that if they could just put some sand in the gears, it would slow it down. Maybe there was an argument within cabinet, and there were people who wanted to be. Well, I think there were people who were angry with the Guardian and just wanted to do something, or to be seen to be doing something. But I think the cooler heads now admit it was not only pointless, it was harmful to the British government to behave in that way.
One of your reporters has written that while working on the NSA story, words disappeared from his computer screen. Has that ever happened to you?
Hasn't happened to me. No, that was the Luke Harding who wrote the book. He said that as he was sitting there, he would sort of write a sentence and then the cursor would start rubbing it out for the...
Should we be paranoid?
Oh, I think so, yes. Wouldn't you? I mean, don't you think? I mean, if you read Snowden and you read what they can do with these machines that we both of us have in front of us, they can do anything.
Are you confident that all your communications is monitored by someone?
I would have thought so, wouldn't you?
Yeah, probably. Mm. What do you say to those people who claim that the Guardian has actually undermined national security? That there is, you act irresponsibly, that you basically enable our enemies, if you define Russia and China as our enemies, for example. Is there somewhere there a valid point?
Well, it's terribly difficult to have that discussion because... it's an easy accusation to make, and you say, well, can you give us an example? And they won't. They say, no, well, you know, we're not going to give you examples. So it's an easy hit to make. And as I say, it's what they said with WikiLeaks. And then 2 or 3 years later, they say, well, okay, we admit no harm with WikiLeaks. So you sort of expect that they would make that argument. I mean, in general terms, I think we acted very responsibly.
But where do you draw the line as editor? When does the responsibility... Where do you go too far? Where do you become irresponsible?
Well, let me tell you how I think we behaved responsibly. We had more than 100 points of contact with the British and American governments and their agencies in advance of publishing the stories. And again, I think this is a discussion that people who are on the state side of things need to think about how to handle these conversations better. And the best conversations we had were in America, where you could ring up the agency directly and say, we have this document, we will be publishing it tomorrow. Can we go through it? It's 20 pages long. We're thinking of publishing pages 5, 7, and 9. Do you have any problems with it? And they would go and get that document, and they would say, yes, on page 5, there is something that gives us a worry. Why does that give you a worry? And you would have quite good conversations in which you try to minimize any risk of harm. The British government tended to play it in a different way, which was just to say, we're not going to discuss that. And so again, which is better? But we had many, 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 many conversations in advance of publication, and I think we published about, it's probably about 2 or 3% of the material that we had. We set very strict guidelines as to stuff that we weren't even going to look at, because we weren't going to look at the uses of intelligence in wartime, in Iraq or Afghanistan. So I think we behaved responsibly, and the private feedback from people who are involved in intelligence and government was that they also think that. That's not what they say publicly, of course, but privately, they say, people I respect say, we can see no harm. We think you behaved responsibly.
You mentioned wartime intelligence. What other kind of information would you typically take out and not publish?
Well, I didn't look at this stuff. So, you can imagine the stuff that would be there.
But as editor, you had the final word on publishing.
Yeah.
So, that kind of information, we will not run it.
Well, I think Snowden was pretty clear in what he was trying to expose, which was not the use of targeted intelligence against enemies. It was the mass surveillance of entire populations of civilians, everyone in this room, and the collection of all that data without any kind of proper discussion, legal basis, or oversight. Those are very different things from following a bad guy in the bad lands of Pakistan. They're different things.
Edward Snowden ended up as an asylum seeker in Russia. Is there any conclusion we should draw from that? How did you react to that? A country that is not maybe a model of democracy.
Well, quite a lot of the people involved in these stories are in some form of exile. So Julian is locked up in a room in London. Sarah Harrison is in Berlin. Sarah Harrison, who worked for Wikileaks, who helped Snowden get out of Hong Kong, feels that she can't come back to London. Laura Poitras, the filmmaker who's in Berlin, won't travel to London. Edward Snowden's in Moscow. Some people think these are not good people. Some people think they're heroes. I think that Snowden ought to be able to go back to America with a publicly arguable defense. So I think he accepts that they would prosecute him. But under the Espionage Act, he would not have a defense. He would not be able to explain his motive for doing something. And that feels to me that there's something wrong about the Espionage Act, as there is about the Official Secrets Act in the UK, that you can't explain to a jury why you did something.
So what will happen with Snowden?
I fear that he'll be in Russia for some time.
Some time means?
It's unknowable, but I think it quite suits the American government to have him there. They know that he's not leaking anything. He's not an active danger to the state. He's done what he's done. It looks terrible being there, frankly. It's uncomfortable for him, and it means that he doesn't come back to the United States, where there would be uncomfortable questions. So it quite suits them to have him there.
And what do the Russians think?
Don't know.
You've really been setting the benchmark in journalism for many years now. What is the next big thing for The Guardian? After phone hacking, WikiLeaks, NSA?
I do know. We have some good stories.
Might come, talk about it for 5 minutes.
Coming along, which I couldn't possibly tell you about. But I mean, in broad terms, there are three things we want to be on the Guardian with. One is global. Most news organizations are retreating from the world at a time when our lives can only be understood in global terms, I think.
How many foreign correspondents do you have?
About, well, it's complicated now because we have about 50 journalists in America and about 20 in Australia. So that's about 70. And then we have about, so it's probably about 100 abroad. We're going to increase that. Because I think the fact that most other papers are retreating from the world gives the Guardian a huge opportunity of being out there in the world. The second thing we want to be is open, which is not just about being free, but about techniques of journalism that harness the information infrastructure that now exists. And the third thing we want to be is digital. You could say we are digital already, but I want to be even more digital in terms of fully understanding and taking advantage of the technologies that the incredible technologies that now exist to publish.
It's an extremely valuable service, public service. We are a lot of people here who follow you online, but we're not paying. How will you survive?
Well, last year we made £70 million from digital, so that's mainly advertising and sponsorship. So £70 million is not enough, but it's not nothing. It's quite a lot of money, and we're really in year zero of digital publishing, and we've now become the biggest serious English language paper in the world. We've overtaken the New York Times, and you know, most of Africa and most of India hasn't yet come on stream. So the potential for becoming much larger at a time when there is going to be a huge amount of advertising money switching into digital, that's the calculation. It's an experiment, but everything's an experiment at the moment.
So you might be safe, but how concerned are you about the future of serious news reporting in the Western world?
Very, very concerned, because there is no. I mean, you can criticize the Guardian model, or you could imagine something which is the opposite of the Guardian model. Say the Times of London has decided to do the opposite, which is to essentially try and recreate a 19th century model of a very tight paywall around the content, and you know where that leads. That leads to a small. Does anybody read the Times of London here? Two people.
And how many people read the Guardian?
How many people read the Guardian? Okay, there you are. That's the two publishing models.
Which model Dagens Nyheter uses.
So you can put a complete paywall around your content, and you will have a small elite audience, probably of people who work in foreign policy, or you can have a massive general audience, and both are experiments. And I don't think that the Times would say, if they were honest, they would say that they had got the economic model predictably right any more than we could. But I know which side of that I would rather be on. And I know, you know, the people who are the commercial directors of The Guardian believe they're more likely to make money out of our model than their model.
But if you said you were concerned about the future of serious news reporting, if that is in danger, what can we do about it?
Well, we have to do better journalism. We have to make the case.
Is that enough?
It's not enough, but if you're going to make the case for journalism as a public service, then you have to do it. And I think that the journalism that people see and believe is useful and valuable to society, there will be ways of sustaining that. If you lose that vision, then why should anybody pay for it except as entertainment? Or why should anybody value it? So I think we have to keep re-convincing the public that there is something about the things that we do as opposed to the things that everybody in this room can do, because everybody in this room can publish. But there is something particular about journalism which we have to make the case for over and over again.
The Guardian has a coffee shop in London.
Yeah, I've never been to it.
Why do you have a coffee shop?
It was a clever idea that there's an area of London which is where the sort of digital startups are. There's a roundabout there, so it's inevitably become known as Silicon Roundabout. And it was the idea actually of the technology people who are covering technology, that they would create a little sort of island for the Guardian down there, and they would sell coffee. But I must go there soon. It sounds great.
You played the piano since you were a child, and you've written about the parallels between this pursuit and digital news. Can you explain that?
Well, it was about... I'm a very bad pianist, and I gave up when I was about 16, and when I was about 40, I thought, if I don't start playing again now, I never will. And I got quite serious about playing it again. The book is called Play It. I wrote a book about it called Play It Again. And it was really about the parallels of this, that even though I am a very mediocre amateur pianist, that there is a value in amateur music making that is different from professional music making. Nobody in this audience would want to come and pay to come and hear me, but I get great delight from playing with other amateurs and sometimes professionals in a way that is and is wonderful. It has a wonderful value. And as I was writing this book and thinking about the value of amateur endeavour, it coincided with this time in which amateurs were doing what journalists were doing. So this huge explosion in blogging and the ability of anybody to sit down at a computer and write words or pictures or so it's essentially the same amateur pursuit of information, which I, as an editor, I value. I think that's incredibly interesting. And when I talk about open journalism, the way I get to it very quickly, we have a theatre critic called Michael Billington, who's been writing for The Guardian since 1972, and he is the professional. He's a wonderful expert on the theatre. He sits in the front row of an audience for a play at the National Theatre, and there are 900 other people in that audience. So you ask the question, is it conceivable that the other 900 people in the audience have got nothing to say about the play? That can't be plausible. Would you like those 900 people to write about it, or to have the chance to write about it? If so, would you rather they wrote about it somewhere else because they're amateurs and we don't rate them, or would you rather that came to The Guardian? And see, that seems to me such an easy question. Why would you want them writing somewhere else? Because you're just creating competition for The Guardian. So you absolutely want them on The Guardian site. And the combination of the professional, Michael, and the amateurs will give you something more precious and interesting about the play. It will be better journalistically. So that's open journalism. And that seems to me, I've never in any audience have I found anybody who thinks that's a bad idea. It arises two more quite more difficult questions. How do you sort out the bad ones from the good ones? Because most of them won't be very good writers, and so you have to work out who are the voices that you want to promote and listen to. And the second question is, if it works for theatre, does it work for foreign reporting and science and the environment and home affairs? And the answer is always yes. It always works. So That's why I believe in this thing that I call open journalism. And that was the parallel. Sorry, that's a long answer to your question. But the value of that amateur endeavor in my professional life felt to me not dissimilar from me fumbling around trying to play Chopin.
And you learned to play Chopin's ballet in the middle of these journalistic revelations. How on earth was that possible?
I went on a piano course, and does anybody know the Chopin ballade? The Chopin ballade. Has anybody seen the film The Pianist? It's the piece that the pianist plays there to save his life. It's a horrendously difficult piece, and many professional pianists are scared of this piece. And I went on a piano course in France, and there was a bloke like me. He'd not done much with his life. He was a sort of slightly sad character. But on the last day of the course, he sat down and he just played the first Chopin ballade. And I was sort of stunned. And I thought, if he could play the Chopin ballade, that must mean that I can play the Chopin ballade. And so it sort of started as a kind of sort of exercise in curiosity. What would it take? And I started keeping a diary, which coincided with WikiLeaks and phone hacking. And at the end of it, I performed it in public.
How on earth did you find time to do that in the middle of all this?
I got up.
And write a book.
I got up 20 minutes earlier.
When do you go up? When do you wake up every morning?
Oh, I got up at 10 to 7 instead of 10 past 7.
Okay. Alan Rusbridger, thank you very much indeed for joining us here today.
Well, you can feel the warmth, I hope.
Thank you.
An extraordinary achievement and a long way to go. We have 15 minutes, a few questions. Please, audience, sharp, specific questions, just directly to the point, and we can take 4 or 5, maybe twice, if you really behave. All right? So here we go. One there, and then the next mic is here.
Yes, thank you. My question is about the role of news bureaus. To the best of my knowledge, we only have one in Sweden. And when they don't get it right, which they didn't a year ago when the death of General Giap in Vietnam, I got the Swedish television to make a change in their so-called facts about the Vietnam War. But I then wrote to the 4 major newspapers and Swedish television to ask them about the role of TT. One of them was Mr. Wolodarski. What the role of these when they get it wrong? Do you have another one than just Reuters in the UK?
Here, Red.
When we look at the various leaks that we're talking about, I think one of the questions that we should ask ourselves also is what happens outside of these leaks? These leaks tend to bring up the role of journalism in democratic society, but it also raises the question, what kind of critical journalism is going on when there are no leaks? And so my question is, if we're thinking specifically about post-911 journalism in the United States, for example, and this question of surveillance that Snowden has brought up, the relationship between large news corporations in the United States and the very industries they're supposed to be reporting on, large tech industries, the internet companies that spread their news, and the lack of critical reporting in the U.S. and the relationship to the political economy of journalism. And that's not just an American question. I think that's a question for European journalism as well. What happens when we don't have leaks, and what happens when these leaks challenge the economic base from which these newspapers operate?
Yeah. Thanks. The fundamental question about the economic independence of media generally, please.
And just a very simple question. Have you been approached by the NSA in a way similar to that approach by the British government?
Okay, let's take these 3 questions, Alan, if you can.
First question on news. If I've understood your question, we have AP, Reuters, AFP, and the press association. So we have news bureau. I mean, if the question is about what should happen when you get things wrong, you should correct them, in my view. The question about challenging the power of big companies, and which may be, some people find it difficult to believe that you could take advertising through one door and write about these companies in the same breath. I've never found it a problem. I don't mean to sound flippant about it, because I know that in some countries, some societies, this is a problem. But I mean, we have flayed the banks, the petrochemical companies, the tech companies. We've pursued tax avoidance. We've written endlessly about tax avoidance by corporations, their environmental behavior, and so on and so forth. And I've never known anybody to turn around and say, I'm not going to advertise in The Guardian because of that. In fact, if anything, I think The Guardian has more respect because we do that, and people want the halo effect of publishing in The Guardian. But if the question is specifically about the tech industry, I think that is an underreported industry. And I don't think it's because we have a sort of relationship with these companies. It's just that I think we've been slow to be as watchful about those industries as others. And the NSA, they haven't been in touch.
But Alan, if I can come back to the economic issue, is there something you think you have a critical audience, a critical mass audience in Britain and a tradition, and you saw the hands that came up here. So if you've obviously succeeded in getting onto a path that is manageable, but if you look at Russia and in many other places, the economic power over media is formidable. And is there anything in your learning path that is translatable, that one can argue for? Because most of us feel that with the economic power, the political economy of concentration of economic power, we're getting into a more difficult world. Mm. And while you may succeeding, many small other others don't know the practice of succeeding.
Mm. Well, I think the most difficult question in all this is the question of ownership and concentration of ownership. It's a really difficult question, because it's really a question for it's almost a sort of economist question, and the Leveson inquiry didn't get into it. It was just too complicated. So how do you define a market if you're going to say, well, Rupert Murdoch's got too much power in Britain? He will turn around and say, but I'm not in Britain, I'm in the world, or I'm in Europe, or measure me like this, or don't measure me like that. I've got Sky TV here, but that's not really British, that's really European. You know, what's this thing? Are you going to include the BBC, or you're not going to include the BBC? Are you going to count in the internet? Because if it's the internet, we're tiny. And so trying to get a slippery thing about how big the concentration should be is really difficult, but it's a really good thing to try and think about. The second thing is that in countries like Russia and Turkey, what's happening is that the president invites his friends to buy the newspapers. So you get this thing in which you haven't got direct control by the state, but the favors are put in a different kind of way. So you get corporate owning of the media, which has a very pernicious effect on journalism, but no one can accuse the state of exercising it. So these questions of ownership become sharper and sharper. The traditional shareholder model of ownership is in trouble, because these are people who have lived with very large profits consistently for decades, centuries. And if you want large profits out of newspapers today, and you screw down the costs, then you're going to destroy the newspapers. So I think the question of ownership becomes a very important thing, and at the Scott Trust, the Guardian is owned by a trust, but that does two things. It exists to make sure these questions of financial perpetuity are uppermost in their minds, but they at the same time want to protect the editor and keep the independence of the journalism. And so I feel very blessed that I've got a form of ownership that I don't think it's a coincidence that the Guardian is able to do the kind of journalism it does with that kind of ownership. So,
but how much equity do you have in that trust? If you start to make losses, for how long will it be viable, the company?
There's about £1 billion.
Okay. And how do you define the Guardian's market?
Meaning?
Is it British? Is it the world?
How do I define it?
Yeah.
Oh, no, it's definitely global. We couldn't survive as a British only paper, I don't think.
Getting to the core of the matter, soulmates and your business and selling shirts and everything belongs to it. But you're succeeding and something needs to be learned.
I mean, we have to find multiples. You know, it used to be very simple. It used to be people who bought the newspaper, and it used to be people who advertised in it. And now we started a membership scheme, which is about live events. We do dating. We do masterclasses. We do careers advice. We do many things. But
the traditional paper, the circulation now is
190. Yeah.
In a world of 9 billion.
And online,
let's
you have almost
where
100
we
million.
Can get.
We have about six million a day who come in to read The Guardian, and the paper is a small element of that now.
Yeah.
Maybe the network that you are creating is something big for the future. 20-second questions from three more, and then we're going to round up.
I would like to put a question.
Be a journalist now, 20 seconds.
20 seconds. Protection of the source. You did deal with two very important issues here of different nature. So the protection of the source.
Next one.
Did Rupert Murdoch, Rebecca Brooks, or Andy Coulson ever contact you directly? And if so, what did they say?
Daniel Ellsberg said something very sad on TV last night. He said all these disclosures have not led to any change of public policy. And what you're saying today makes me very sad to think that we have had these fantastic disclosures. And what is it leading to? A kind of comedy of errors? Somebody said in the Pentagon, this is leading to putting American lives at danger. Couldn't you take that up? How many American lives have been put at danger with Snowden's exposure?
Sources, danger. Alan, maybe you can respond.
Protection source is really, really important question. And it's one that I think journalists are only just beginning to understand. So I think, funnily enough, since Snowden, there have been a couple of instances in Britain where it's become apparent that the police were trawling through journalists' phone logs to find out who their sources were. Same thing's been happening in America. And that, I think, is just the tip of the iceberg of the use of the authorities, of this ability to go through anybody's emails, anybody's metadata, to find out where they've been, to track them as they go and meet a source, their text messages. So I think it's dawning on journalists that this is a very dangerous thing for them and for their contacts, and potentially lethally dangerous in dealing with people abroad. So journalists have got to smarten up their act, learn how to do encryption, and take all this much more seriously. And it's one of the reasons why it dismays me when journalists say that this is not in the public interest to reveal this source. I think that's very cavalier in the treatment of their own sources. Rupert Murdoch and Andy Coulson have not been in touch. Rebecca Brooks, at the beginning of the story, issued a statement attacking The Guardian and a not very truthful statement, but she hasn't been in touch since. The changes in public policy is a troubling question, and I think I think when you look at what Snowden revealed, it must be obvious to any audience that the potentially maligned uses of these technologies exist. It obviously varies from country to country, but if you go to Germany, you don't have to talk about this for very long. It's obvious. It's obvious in German history. Maybe in Britain, where we like James Bond, it takes a bit longer to. But it's obvious. It's obvious. You know, if you've read 1984, if you've read your Orwell, you know that this is. So the only question is who is overlooking this? What form of oversight do you have? And I think the fact that politicians don't want to engage in this, that the British Parliament has barely discussed it, is a really bad sign. Because if you're trying to say we know this could be a terrible technology in the wrong hands, then you really want to know that the people who are overlooking it are doing it properly, that they understand it, that they're listening to the balance, because we are asking them to make the balance on our behalf between civil liberties and privacy and confidentiality and the freedom of the press and security. And if you have a bunch of politicians who say basically we don't want to discuss it, or just say we shouldn't be discussing it because that's not the role of the press, then that's a really dangerous situation. But it is there for all of us to discuss. You know, you can, the issues that Snowden has laid out in front of us are so rich and many, and the web exists as a place where we can all contribute to that and chip in with our knowledge and our expertise, and create the debate that the politicians are frightened of having.
Thank you, Alan. Thank you for showing the way ahead in practice and in journalism. Thank you, Peter Wolodarski, Dagens Nyheter. Thank you, Right Livelihood Foundation. Many of us look forward to seeing you receive the award later today. I thank you, all of you who have come, and let's celebrate once again this pragmatic, real way of getting the free word out in a modern world. Alan Rusbridger, The Guardian, thank you very much.
Thank you.